Good afternoon, and welcome to the Dana-Farber's live web chat series. I'm Dr. Ursula Matalonis, and today we're partnering with the Susan F. Smith Center for Women's Cancers and also the National Ovarian Cancer Coalition for live discussion on ovarian cancer treatments, risk factors, and what's new in ovarian cancer. We'll be talking with medical oncologist Dr. Susanna Campos, who's on my far right, and Dr. Panos Constantinopoulos, another medical oncologist here, both at Dana-Farber, and both treat patients with ovarian cancer, participate in research studies. It'll be a great conversation today. So if you have a question, please email webchats@dfci.harvard.edu or send us a tweet at Dana-Farber using the hashtag DFCI web chats. And we really look forward to having a very lively conversation today, and definitely try to get your question answered by one of these two experts. And I'm going to chime in every once in a while because there's a lot to talk about. So I'm going to get things going. Question number one. So these are actually questions that have been sent in by you, the audience, and we're going to go through them one by one, and then we got a few extras this morning. So number one, Dr. Campos, the question is there more than one type or subtypes of ovarian cancer, and are all ovarian cancers treated the same way?
You know, I think that's an excellent question. There are many types of ovarian cancer, and we traditionally categorize them into a high-grade serous carcinoma or serous carcinoma, endometrioid, mucinous, and clear cell. But over the course of the last several years, what we've identified is even within the serous adenocarcinoma that we're subdividing, we're partitioning out the high grade and the low grade. And the question is, that's quite important because we're starting to understand some molecular alterations that might guide us in terms of treatments individually. I think it's a very good question, one that we kind of still struggle with in some subtypes of ovarian cancer. Traditionally, they're still treated with platinum and taxanes, but there's been some research, specifically in the mucinous type of ovarian cancer, as to whether or not we really should be adhering to the carboplatin and Taxol, or perhaps employing a GI regimen. So there's a nice ongoing clinical study that I think recently just closed that may shed some light into the equation. So
yeah, that's good. And I'm gonna let Panos chime in here, but I think it's really important that the audience understand that, I think in ovarian cancer, we really need to do a better job of improving how we're treating women. And one of the, I think, very exciting next steps in clinical trial development has been exactly what Sue just said, sub-splitting out the different histologic subtypes of ovarian cancer. You would never think about treating breast cancer in one way anymore. Mm-hmm. So it just doesn't make sense that in ovary cancer that we would think about it as just one cancer. So certainly, as Sue mentioned, high-grade serous ovarian cancer, most common type of ovary cancer we treat with platinum. Panos, do you have any thoughts about high-grade serous? It's certainly an area of laboratory interest to Panos.
Yes. So high-grade serous cancer is a very heterogeneous type of cancers. We now know there have been a lot of analysis, both in terms of the DNA, the protein, and the RNA of these tumors, and we know that they're different subtypes of this high-grade serous. So there are tumors that may have, 50% of them actually have defects in a DNA repair pathway called homologous recombination, which genes like BRCA1 and BRCA2 are involved. There's another 20% of tumors that actually have a specific alteration called cyclin E amplification. These tumors usually don't respond so well to platinum chemotherapy, and we're trying to figure out other approaches that we can target them. There is another 2 to 3% of tumors that have mismatch repair defects. So we're trying to understand, as Sue and Ursula mentioned, these tumors better so that we could potentially treat them in an individual manner. And I have to say here that here at Dana-Farber, we have embarked in this initiative, and we try for every patient who's coming in our institution genotype their tumor for 275 different genes and get an individual report, so that we could potentially identify for each patient appropriate treatments, streamline them into appropriate clinical trials, that we could offer them what we call the personalized treatment for each patient and for each patient tumor.
Yeah, That's great. More to come on that. Sue, I was recently diagnosed with ovarian cancer, and I'm trying to wrap my head around all the terminology. Can you explain what the CA125 number is and why doctors track it?
The CA125 is a protein antigen on a tumor, and it's specific in ovarian cancer. However, it can actually be elevated in, say, for example, certain types of uterine cancer. But it is a marker, a serum protein that we actually measure at the time of diagnosis. In some cases, the tumor marker is elevated in individuals with ovarian cancer. More often than not, it is. But there are times when individuals can have ovarian cancer and that CA125 is normal. I think it's important to know that that level is never zero. In a normal individual, an individual without a malignancy, say, it's somewhere between 0 and 35. But it is a tool, a tracking device. So if elevated at the beginning of treatment, we track it every single time the individual comes in for chemotherapy. And what we hope is that we see a nice decline in that CA125. I think we all agree that we spend a lot of time talking about the CA125 and that it is a test that is not a good screening test. And I know there's many questions out there, why not use this as a screening tool? It is quite nonspecific and nonsensitive. For example, individuals who, young women who are menstruating, pregnant, a urinary tract infection, any kind of pelvic inflammation can cause that increase in CA125. And I think it's important to note, as individuals, as we're tracking that CA125, there could be a little bit blurb. And so we often counsel patients not to get too apprehensive if it goes up or down by a couple of points, but it's simply the trend of the CA125. But the hope is indeed that that marker normalizes at the conclusion of therapy. So it is basically a tracking device.
Yeah, a very good point. And I think as we're talking today, I think all of us are gonna talk about a little bit about screening. Although I wish we had better screening tests, but also new therapeutics and the MUC16 protein that's stuck onto ovarian cancer cells that shed moiety is the CA125. And now we should have medications and drugs that are targeting that MUC16 right, prior to being shedded from the CA125. So Sue, that's perfect. Thank you, Panos. What other biomarkers are used by Dana-Farber for ovarian cancer progression besides CA125?
So the majority of the time, as Sue mentioned, if the CA125 is elevated, this is a tumor marker, this is the biomarker, the blood marker that we use. There are occasions where we could, for certain types of ovarian cancer, like the mucinous type, where we could follow other biomarkers like the CEA, which is the carcinoembryonic antigen, or the CA19-9, which is the cancer antigen 19-9. There's another assay called HC4, which has been FDA approved actually for following to track progression of disease, but this is not used very frequently. But there are many occasions where there is actually no blood biomarker that's elevated in patients with ovarian cancer, and then in that situation we have to follow them with imaging studies like CAT scan or sometimes, depending on the scenarios, PET scans.
Yeah.
So this is how we...
Yeah. So I think HE4 is probably what this individual is driving at. I don't use it. Do you use it, Sue?
No, there's indications in terms of when an individual presents with an ovarian mass, and sometimes that's used complex with the CA125 to try to help the surgeon. Could this be malignant or non-malignant? I think different institutions use it differently. We haven't here used it.
Used it too much.
Usually if the CA125 will dictate.
Yeah,
we'll tell the story.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And obviously for women who have granulosa cell tumors, we use inhibin A and B, because that's the other biomarker we use.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Panos, this is a biggie. What are areas, and this is directed towards Panos, but I'm obviously going to let Sue chime in too. What are areas researchers are focusing on the most with regards to ovarian cancer treatment?
So I think that the biggest area of investigation right now about in ovarian cancer is try to understand the different molecular pathways that are involved that drive carcinogenesis, ovarian cancer, ovarian carcinogenesis. Because if we understand the different pathways, then we could potentially develop therapies that we could target these pathways. So there is a lot of excitement right now about targeting DNA damage repair pathways. So many times ovarian cancers are defective in terms of their ability to repair DNA. So we have drugs that are actually are directed against this DNA repair pathways. For example, one of these drugs are PARP inhibitors that we use. There are other, there's a lot of research on various signaling pathways that are frequently activated in ovarian cancer. For example, the MAP kinase pathway, the PI3K pathway, and we actually have a lot of clinical trials in our institution that target these particular pathways. There is a lot of excitement about targeting blood angiogenesis, which is tumors forming new blood vessels. And so we have a lot of drugs that are targeting new blood vessel formation. There are a lot of drugs, novel drug, and a lot of research that is targeting cellular proliferation, P53 mutations, which are also commonly expressed in ovarian cancer, particularly the high-grade serous ovarian cancer, which 100% is associated with P53 mutations. So I think the biggest area of research right now is, again, understanding that not all ovarian cancers are created equal, and that there are several different pathways that are being driving this disease, these different diseases, and that we should treat these different diseases based on the particular molecular pathway that's been responsible right. In these cases.
I think that's a good lead-in into the fact that, you know, ovarian cancer is not necessarily a one mutation type of a cancer like EGFR mutation lung cancer, or even overexpressing cancer, or like HER2 breast cancer. And I know that you know, our group has really taken the premise that, you know, maybe we should start targeting various pathways.
Right.
Sue Campos has run two trials now that actually have combined drugs of different pathways, specifically of anti-angiogenic drugs and an EGFR inhibitor, right. Plus an anti-angiogenic plus a PI3 kinase inhibition. Yeah. And that's definitely been a theme that our group has really started to study. Do you want to chat about those?
You know, these are the studies that we have done. I think what I've gotten even more interested in the last is, you know, we can find these mutations, but what are the mutations that actually drive the cancer
right.
pathway?
Right.
And we've spent a lot of time, and patients have been amazing in terms of participating in these clinical trials, in terms of clinical trials with drugs that block new blood vessel formation. And so we're at a point where we see people responding brilliantly, and that we're at a point where we don't see people responding. So the question really is, I know you've done a lot of work with the signature, the angiogenic signature. Who are these individuals that indeed do respond? So we can give the drug to the individuals that do, but perhaps save some collateral toxicity.
Right.
I was interested in the American Society of Clinical Oncology meetings this year, where there was two very important abstracts presented in terms of individuals who got this drug called bevacizumab, but who are those individuals that did respond, maybe responded better, responded poorly. So
yeah.
I thought that was
yeah.
intriguing at ASCO this year.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
I know. I think there's a lot going on about, you know, we have all these different medications, although we need more targeted therapies in
right.
ovarian cancer, but bevacizumab is the one that's been studied a lot, but you know, it has toxicities.
Right.
You want to choose our patients carefully who go on the trials and receive that drug. Dr. Campos, are there any treatments available that are easier on the body than standard chemotherapy?
You know, there are different types of chemotherapy. Chemotherapy has notoriously side effects, and we try to finesse the side effects using supportive elements, sometimes even utilizing chemotherapy in a different fashion. We've started to use chemotherapy instead of an every 3-week session, perhaps a weekly session, which mm-hmm. really tries to mm-hmm. minimize some of the toxicity. So that doesn't truly address that question because it's still a chemotherapy, but it's a way of quality of life. They take a pill per day, they carry on their lives in a normal fashion, and patients have responded in some cases, not all granted, but in a very, very nice light. Bevacizumab Avastin is not a chemotherapy, but a biological therapeutic. It's easier on the body, but it has its unique side effects. So we're very cautious in terms of administering that and how we do that and to whom we do that, to be honest with you.
Oh, good. Panos, there are a couple questions about specifically PARP inhibitors and updating the audience, again, quickly as we can. And then also about immunotherapy. You know, we've heard a lot about the power of immunotherapy drugs in melanoma, lung cancer, bladder cancer, but
say that the immune system, we have very, very good evidence that the immune system plays a very important role in controlling malignant progression in ovarian cancer. Actually, about 12 years ago, investigators saw that if you look at patients' tumors, if these tumors included specific lymphocyte-specific immune cells that are actually could potentially kill the tumor, these patients actually did better. These patients live longer. So there is no question that the immune system plays an important role in ovarian cancer progression. The question is how can we harness the immune system? So there have been a lot of approaches in terms of trying to stimulate the immune system to attack the tumor. And for example, there have been vaccine approaches, there have been approaches that try to target the immune system against the CA125 protein that's been produced. But these approaches so far have not really produced very good results. However, recently we're very, very excited about these drugs called immune checkpoint inhibitors, which, as Ursula mentioned, they have been now FDA approved in diseases like melanoma. These drugs are like pembrolizumab or ipilimumab. And these drugs, what they do is that there is this theory that the tumor cells are actually put a brake in the immune system that's not allowing the immune system to fight the tumor. And what these drugs do is they release the brake so that the immune system can fight back the tumor. So we're very excited about these immune checkpoint inhibitors, and there are now clinical trials in our institution where we're asking the question whether these drugs, which have had such a great activity against in other tumors like melanomas, renal cell cancers, whether we can see similar activity in ovarian cancer. And that's actually a work in progress right now.
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to come back to you on that. Sue. A big question, and one that we can spend a whole few days talking about. Are there mechanisms yet to reverse platinum-resistant cancer? And what ways have been attempted to try to reverse that platinum resistance
yeah.
and kind of make the cells once again platinum sensitive?
Yes, and that is actually a very, very important area in terms of clinical research that, I mean, there are certain in BRCA mutation carriers that can be reverse mutations that can make patients, again, susceptible to certain chemotherapeutic agents. I mean, this is your specialty, so.
Yeah. So essentially, as Sue mentioned, so this is one of the way that this happens is that tumors may have BRCA mutations which cause DNA repair defects in their platinum sensitive, and then this DNA repair is reverted, and actually can lead to a platinum resistance. So attacking this DNA repair mechanism and their clinical trials that we have now using ATR inhibitor or NTM inhibitors, which are through our phase one program, we could potentially reinstitute clinical trial. Platinum sensitivity. Ursula actually recently ran a clinical trial of a drug called SGI-110 in combination with carboplatin. That was actually an agent that could potentially reverse platinum resistance, and we're waiting to see what the results of this study are. So, but the most important thing here is to understand how platinum resistance occurs, and there are multiple different mechanisms that platinum resistance occurs, and in this situation, we should target those mechanisms so that we could potentially revert that. The other thing is that even if a tumor becomes platinum resistant, that doesn't mean that there may be other drugs that we can use, and we have clinical trials that we will be talking about that could potentially be used for platinum-resistant tumors.
Right. And certainly we have a new fellow who's joined our group, Elizabeth Stover, who who works in Levi Garraway's lab here, who's going to work on platinum resistance and trying to reverse it. So it's great to have a targeted MD PhD working on that. This is a quickie. I'm going to answer this one because it's easy. Is there a connection between ovarian cancer and HPV? Answer is no. HPV causes cervical cancer and head and neck cancers. Sue, when is the best time to consider a clinical trial? If you join a clinical trial right away, does that mean you may be using drugs you cannot use again in the future?
Sure. That is an excellent question. And in clinical trials, I think at every interaction with your clinician, as you choose and as a team, you know, delegate your therapy, you should ask the question, is there a clinical trial for which I am eligible for? Oftentimes, we have clinical trials more in the recurrent setting. There are phase one, there are phase two, and certainly phase three clinical trials. So let's give you an example in the recurrent setting. You should always ask the question, what do I have at my disposal? Standard therapies, there are numerous standard therapies, and what clinical trials could I utilize at this time? It's about organizing and tailoring the therapy to the individual so that at the end of the day, as this disease, we treat this disease, you always have as many options as you possibly can. So I said every encounter, when you're about to change therapy, ask the questions, am I eligible for a clinical trial? And there'll be times when a standard therapy is more practical, and there'll be times when a clinical trial should actually be considered. So it's quite important. As you pick a clinical trial, it's not that it eliminates certain things, but there is a notion that they have eligibility criteria for a clinical trial, so oftentimes they'll say cannot have more than two or three prior lines. So this is very, very important to work with your clinician and say, how do I position my choices so that I have more choices as years pass? So
right, that's a really good point, because some of the clinical trials we have open are very early on in the treatment of ovarian cancer. Yet some other trials, you can have received a number of different lines of therapy. And what Panos was referring to before is our oncoprofile or profile mapping that we do on all patients who walk into the Dana-Farber really can give us some new hints or clues about what potential clinical trials are available, if there's a AKT mutation or a PI3 kinase mutation. So it gives us a lot of information. Sue, another question for you. For someone who's diagnosed with stage one ovarian cancer, what is the chance of recurrence, and what is the chance after 5 years?
Yeah. So, you know, when you think about ovarian cancer, we often talk about, you know, epithelial ovarian cancer, which is 90% of the ovarian cancer. So a stage one, overall, a stage one 5-year survival rate, if you were to Google it, is 90%. And I think it's important if it wants to be specific to look at different types of stage one. So you have stage 1A, stage 1B, and stage 1C. Take, for example, a stage 1C, according to the literature that exists recently, it's about 85% 5-year survival rate. Now, let's talk about different types of ovarian cancers, like stromal type of tumors, where a stage one is a 95% 5-year survival. So, you know, when we talk about, we always measure in 5 years, and is this, their magic of 5 years, a line in the sand, it tells us about the biology of the disease. I think it's very hard to give statistics after 5 years, but obviously if people haven't recurred in the 5 years, the likelihood of them recurring in stage one is quite low, and it's quite reassuring.
Yeah, it's great. Panos, my mother was diagnosed with ovarian cancer and was genetically tested, but results did not show BRCA1 or 2 mutations, so she was BRCA1/2 negative. Are there other genes that could cause ovarian cancer? Certainly a very appropriate question given the New England Journal PALB2 story in breast cancer.
Mm-hmm. So absolutely, there are other genes that are involved besides, although the majority, 90% of familial hereditary ovarian cancer is caused actually by BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations, there are other genes that have been involved in hereditary ovarian cancer. For example, there are the mismatch repair genes that are involved in the so-called Lynch syndrome, which causes familial clustering of tumors like colon cancer, uterine cancer, and ovarian cancer. The genes include MSH2, MLH1, and MSH6, and sometimes PMS2. So there are also some data about rarely some genes called RAD51C and RAD51D that have been shown in some ovarian cancer families. Ursula mentioned the PALB2 story, which has been found to be associated in patients with breast cancer. In our institution here, we have this next generation sequencing platform that is looking 25 different familial cancer genes. So every patient who we refer here to for genetic counseling, they talk to them about this myriad 25 gene panel testing that that includes all these genes that I mentioned, the mismatch repair genes, as well as the RAD51C, RAD51D, PALB2 that Ursula mentioned, and of course BRCA1 and BRCA2. So we get a comprehensive question, answer about whether those genes may be involved. And I want to mention also that in many cases, even when there is a familial, there are families that have a lot of ovarian cancer, we're not able to find a gene. And that doesn't mean that there is no hereditary predisposition. It may very well be a gene that we don't know about, that we haven't figured out. We haven't, and there may well be a hereditary predisposition, even in that case, that we're not able to find. So even if a test is negative, particularly in the setting of a positive family history, that should not definitely gives us the false reassurance that this there's nothing going on. So this patient should follow with their genetic counselor and discuss ways to potentially prevent and screen for this disease.
Good. Sue, what options do ovarian cancer patients have if they have refractory ovarian cancer? And you might want to define for the audience what that means, refractory ovarian cancer. And how successful are these options?
Understood. There are considerable choices to actually be had. We often think of refractory as individuals who progress while they're on their induction therapy of a platinum and taxane. Other people define it within 3 months after completing therapy. I suspect that maybe in that question is also the concept of resistance disease, which is if an individual progresses less than 6 months after finishing their carboplatin and taxane, they're considered resistant. So refractory and resistance. So there are standard options, clearly, and there's liposomal anthracycline, there's topotecan, there's CPT. There are many standard therapies, but this really is the category of individuals that really should be seeking clinical trials, whether they be in phase two clinical trials, whether they be in phase one clinical trials. I think one of the studies that I think has been so illuminating in the last year has been a study called the Aurelia trial, which I think we're going to start to learn a little bit more about. And in this particular trial, patients were treated with bevacizumab, which is Avastin, and chemotherapy. But in that cohort of individuals, bevacizumab and Taxol really outperformed, that combination really outperformed Taxol. And these were, in essence, in patients who had, although we defined them as resistant, if you go back into the study, they're almost refractory because they're within the three-month period. So there are many options, but individuals who find themselves in that situation should ask the question, again, standard therapies, and what are the clinical trials? So they really can really, explore what's out there for them. So there are options, and people shouldn't feel as though their back is against the wall, because there clearly are options, yeah.
Right, right. Do you want to mention the cyclin E story in those patients with platinum refractory?
Yeah, so some patients, we start to know that some of these patients who have platinum refractory disease actually have this cyclin E amplification. It's 20% of the patients, and we're trying to figure out ways, and there are some phase one clinical trials that we have in our institution that target this particular patients who have this alteration and have this platinum resistant and platinum refractory disease.
Yeah. Great. We have a lot of questions. So, So Panos, I'm going to ask you the question, and this is more along the PARP inhibitors, because I asked you about immunotherapy, PARP inhibitors. You get a great answer on immunotherapy, but I want to have you speak specifically about PARP inhibitors, but also your work on HSP90. So the question is, are there drugs that have been found to have a significantly different effect for BRCA-positive versus BRCA-negative patients?
So patients who have a BRCA mutation, who are BRCA positive as we call them, they have a defect in a specific DNA repair pathway called homologous recombination. So they, in other words, they cannot repair DNA damage well. So there are specific drugs that actually cause DNA damage that these tumors cannot repair. And these drugs are PARP inhibitors. So that's one example. Other drugs are platinum. Actually, platinum is a drug that causes DNA damage that is repaired by homologous recombination. So Doxil is another drug that could potentially, so these drugs seem to have a very, very good response, particularly in patients who have BRCA mutation. That doesn't mean that this drug don't work also well in patients who are BRCA negative, but they seem to work very, very well in patients who are BRCA positive. There are also some other drugs that that are being found in the laboratory. For example, there's a phase one study of this drug called sapecitabine, which is a nucleoside analog we have in our institution that seems to work very well in patients who do have this BRCA mutation. So it's important also to underscore that there are other ovarian cancers that, despite the fact that they don't have BRCA mutations, they may also have defective homologous recombination, and they still may respond very well to PARP inhibitors, to platinum, to Doxil, and all these drugs. So even if you're BRCA negative, does not mean that you may not respond to drugs that we know work very well in BRCA-positive patients. And it's actually one of the challenges in ovarian cancer research to try and identify which are these patients who, despite the fact that they don't have a BRCA mutation, may actually respond very well to these drugs.
I mean, Dr. Liu's study that she presented, the American Society of Clinical Oncology, really did highlight that. You know, our colleague utilized two drugs, cedarinib and olaparib versus olaparib, and interestingly enough, even the BRCA-negative mutation individuals responded brilliantly.
Yeah,
actually better.
Right.
So getting to your point, absolutely.
Absolutely.
Sue, hot off the wire, can you comment on ways that women can prevent ovarian cancer?
Ways to wait to prevent ovarian cancer, listen to your body, communicate your symptoms. And I know we take a history every time an individual comes in, and we oftentimes, patients are very quite distraught because they've had symptoms that they think have lasted for a little longer than they should. You know, the symptoms are, in essence, symptoms that are very not unique to women. I mean, in terms of abdominal bloating, early satiety, these things can happen in women all the time. But if there is a constellation of symptoms, a grouping of symptoms, present them to your physician. You know, address the question. Even though ovarian cancer is not as common as breast cancer, it does occur. And present them to your individual and ask the question, should I have an ultrasound? Should I have a gynecological examination? A CA-125 is not the answer at all times. I think one of the key factors, especially when talking to your primary care physician, is to be very, very concrete with your family history. At times, this really clues in a clinician as to the fact this may be an individual from Eastern European descent, what have you, that may be more likely to have ovarian cancer. So taking time to have a detailed ovarian history, family history, is important. There is literature also in terms of the oral contraceptives, and we've learned this over the years, that oral contraceptives can decrease the risk of ovarian cancer. Women have to be mindful, they also have side effects. So talk very cautiously with your clinician.
Right. Sue, also a question from Andy, out of the wire. What are some promising therapies for clear cell cancers, which are usually resistant to chemotherapy?
Yeah, absolutely. This has been one of our thorns on our side. It's been the clear cell histology, that fourth histology we talked about. Actually, we have colleagues here and at MGH also that are working very closely with clear cell and actually looking into anti-angiogenic therapeutics for clear cell carcinoma of the ovary. So that still is there. And again, molecularly profiling these tumors allows us to understand what genetic aberrations exist, and that is really the launching pad to maybe a particular trial, whether it be angiogenesis inhibitors or other inhibitors that, you know, that fit mutations that we find.
Yeah, I think, you know, our uncle panel has been, to me, really important for clear cell cancers.
Yeah.
I mean, I probably more often than not will find PIK3CA mutations.
Right, exactly.
25%,
And
especially
actually,
clear cell,
absolutely.
Yeah.
And for those women who show resistance to platinum, I tend not to go right to Doxil or another chemotherapy, but try to get them
onto a clinical trial.
So, panelists, any thoughts about that?
I think that PIK3CA mutations are 25% of these clear cell tumors, and I think that's great. We're trying to understand clear cell ovarian cancer from a molecular standpoint better now. There is this ARID1A mutations that about 50% of these patients have, and we're trying to find specific vulnerabilities that these patients have. So I think that there's more definitely to come, but in the meantime, I think anti-angiogenic agents, as Sue mentioned, and PIK3CA, PI3K pathway targeted approaches are the best ways to proceed at this point.
Yeah, and I think, again, anecdotally, that the women who respond to agents that involve the PI3 kinase pathway that I've seen have the best responses to have been clear cell cancer. So, I think
there's a lot of preclinical work suggesting that.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay.
Absolutely.
So Sue, a question about nutrition. Can you speak about the role of nutrition in cancer development? And how to eat after treatment to minimize the risk of recurrence?
This is a question that comes up all the time in our clinical visits. Nutrition, the effect of nutrition remains a little bit vague, but if you look in the literature, there are some kind of bullet points that I think we can share with individuals. There are some studies suggesting decrease in your intake of meat, especially red meat. There's some literature regarding the risk of milk and perhaps the hormones that exist in milk. That's been a theory that's been out there for some time. I think the theory that stands now is that a person who actually has a diet that's rich in vegetables, fruits, grains, complex grains, this could be beneficial to a patient with ovarian cancer. I always try to tell my patients, you're just not an individual that has ovarian cancer. You're an individual that has to maintain her heart, her lung, her liver, her colon. So it's important just to have a diet that substantiates that. So I always think that a protein-based diet, complex carbohydrates, minimizing sugar intake, doesn't mean you can't have your cake if you want it sometimes, but be very mindful. It's just not about the issue of ovarian cancer. It's you as an individual, as a whole individual. Yeah.
And Sue, another question for you. What are some of the symptoms of ovarian cancer recurrence? Would it just be an elevated CA-125, or are there other signs I should be looking for?
I mean, that's a very important question. People become very fearful after undergoing, taking the investment in chemotherapy. Oftentimes, if the marker was elevated to begin with, we will know before you have a symptom. It will be a rising CA-125. Let me just mention the fact that if the CA-125 goes up 1 month, it doesn't necessarily mean it's going to continue to go up, so it's the trend of the marker that we follow. There are times where individuals will present to us with either increasing abdominal distension. Oftentimes we hear about changes in bowel habits, mm-hmm. early satiety, mm-hmm. they get full very easily, perhaps shortness of breath. It can be a little bit of everything. We always tell people, understand how you feel now. If you have a symptom, just present it. Let us decipher it.
No, I think that's smart. I think, just listening to your body and us listening to patient symptoms, we really pick up just by talking. And sometimes physical exam doesn't always just sort of clue you into what's going on. Panos, an important question on, can you discuss neuroendocrine ovarian cancer? And I'm going to actually put in there small cell ovarian cancer. Mm-hmm. What's currently known about this disease and its treatment? Is there such a thing as neuroendocrine ovarian cancer of the GI type? If so, what does it mean?
So neuroendocrine tumors are rare tumors. They're only 1 or 2% of ovarian cancers. And they're usually, the most common ones are the small cell, which are the high-grade neuroendocrine tumors, which are usually, there are two types, the small cell hypercalcemic type, which is associated actually with high elevated calcium levels. There's been actually some genetic discovery that shows that there is a specific gene that's mutated for these tumors. These tumors usually involve women who are in their early age, usually age of 20 to 40. Usually, they are quite aggressive tumors. They tend to present not only in the ovaries, but they present with metastatic disease in other places very, very early. And usually, we follow the same principles in terms of management of these tumors with surgery, if we can do surgery, and after surgery, obviously, chemotherapy. We use specific regimen, not exactly the similar regimen as we use for the regular ovarian cancer, but similar regimens. These are the small cell cancers, the neuroendocrine tumors, but there are these low-grade neuroendocrine tumors, the so-called carcinoids. I don't know what this patient is referring to. Usually there can be primary ovarian mucinous carcinoids, which are look like GI tumors, or they can be carcinoids that are metastatic to the ovary from originated from the GI tract, like from colon or the appendix. Frequently, there can be an appendiceal primary carcinoid that has spread to the ovary, or a small bowel carcinoid that has spread to the ovary. These are tumors that are low grade. They're not like the small cell neuroendocrine high grade tumors. We actually have a special clinic here at Dana-Farber for these carcinoid tumors that we send, and they have a special management, which usually depending on their presentation. They can involve either local approaches, for example, radio frequency ablation, depending if they involve the liver, or systemic therapy, like there are drugs like octreotide that can be used in that case. These tumors, the low-grade carcinoid tumors, can be associated also with the so-called carcinoid syndrome because they produce certain substances that can cause various types of reactions. So it's a very, very big umbrella of different rare tumors that need specialized treatment clearly.
So yes, I agree. So I also wanted to follow up on this the small cell because it's a very rare variant. And Sue, do you have any comments on small cell? I mean, I think we've all seen typically very young women with the kind of the hypercalcemic small cell cancer type. What are your thoughts about how best to manage those women?
It's to know what all options are available. I think it's fair to say that we have had a handful of individuals with small cell, and they are difficult malignancies. They can be aggressive. So understanding what they are at time zero is important. And putting our fielders, obviously we're going to treat these individuals with the conventional therapeutics. Yes, we're going to profile them molecularly.
Yep.
But also know that, we've gotten to a point, I know in the past, decade that we've worked, that even high-dose chemotherapy has been brought into the occasion.
Absolutely.
So it's understanding what it is, what it can do, and picking your team very early in the upfront.
I would agree, and I've certainly have, just because of the truly aggressiveness of these cancers, thought about high-dose chemotherapy
and
bone marrow transplantation, which is really the only time that I've ever thought about that.
Indeed,
true. Panos, do you want to speak about the molecular alterations that have been found recently in small cell cancer?
So there was a gene called SMARCA4 that has been found to be associated in about in the majority of patients with small cell cancer of the ovary of the hypercalcemic type, and they're also both somatic. Which means acquired mutation, but they're also germline, so they're families. Actually, this tumor, the small cell ovarian cancer of the hypercalcemic type, sometimes can run into certain families. And there are germline mutations, so inherited mutations, genetic alterations of this particular gene that can run into families, and obviously that has important implications. So, but as Ursula and Sue mentioned, I think that these are very, very aggressive tumors, and obviously knowing this is a very recent discovery, knowing this new gene, and we could potentially try to identify specific vulnerabilities of these tumors so that we could potentially identify therapies that go beyond the chemotherapies that have been mentioned.
Right.
Yeah. And I think it's important to know that if someone's diagnosed with a rare tumor, unfortunately, there are times where people feel, is there a clinical trial for me? It's so rare. Is there active research going on? And there actually is. Yeah. And even national organizations such as NRG has a rare tumor committee that takes these tumors that are rare and really tries to dive into them and try to answer some questions with different chemotherapeutic agents or in molecularly defined situations. So even though you have a rare tumor, it's not that people are not interested.
Yeah. And I think now, more than ever, there's been better collaboration and cross-referencing with folks like us who see women with ovarian cancer, translational scientists, as well as basic scientists. So the speed of the technology has really increased. The price of examining genes has dropped. Mm-hmm. And we're definitely getting more information. So I think it's a really exciting time. I'm just going to go through these questions. I think, so Panos, this is a question that I'm not exactly sure what it means, but I'm going to ask it because it's on our list. Is there any research that is helping us pinpoint or reasonably estimate when the onset of the cancer was? And I'm actually going to expand that question to another sort of realm, is where the onset of the cancer was, given what we've learned in the past few years.
Mm-hmm. This is a great question that Ursula actually expanded. So we have, as Sue initially mentioned, there are different types of ovarian cancer. There is the so-called high-grade serous ovarian cancer. And this tumor, we now have some evidence that it may actually originate not not necessarily in the ovarian tissue, but actually in the fallopian tube tissue, so in the fallopian tube. And usually there is a very clear precursor lesion that's called serous tubal intraepithelial carcinoma, which is present in the fallopian tube. And usually this tumor spreads inside the abdomen to the ovary and elsewhere. Usually these tumors tend to spread quite fast, so we cannot clearly say how long it took. In many cases, it could be actually a few months that this may happen. So it's very, very important to try and identify these precursor lesions, but we're not ready to do that yet. There are also the other types of ovarian cancer, the so-called low-grade serous ovarian cancers, which usually have a good precursor lesions that are these are the borderline ovarian alterations. And these tumors usually have a longer period of progression and lower and longer period of how they develop. So to answer that question, so I think that the how long this ovarian cancer has been is depends on the type of ovarian cancer. It depends on where it originated from. So it's not easy. And I know many women ask the question: how long did I have it inside? How? Why didn't I pick it up? Why did my primary care physician pick it up? And I have to say that in many cases, it's just the nature of this disease that it just spreads so quickly, and it's automatically people present with advanced disease even at a very, very early, very, very quickly. And that's unfortunately how it is. And it's really nobody's fault. Nobody, no physician's fault or no patient's fault. It's just how these tumors sometimes behave.
So we have time for one more question, and then we're gonna wrap up, because I want to hear what everyone's really excited about in ovarian cancer field. But Sue, the last question, and I think I know what this question is: can tumor freezing treatment be used in ovarian cancer or other cancers in the pelvic area? Is it successful? And I'm gonna rephrase this question, because I think this is what that means: is that if somebody has an isolated recurrence. Is it possible to treat that isolated recurrence with something besides chemotherapy, besides surgery?
Absolutely, and these are a few cases, but they do exist. So if an individual recurs and there is an isolated lesion, we often look to a multidisciplinary approach. We reach out to our surgical colleagues and ask the question, can these be resected, number one. We reach out to our radiation oncology colleagues, can this be radiated? But we also use the tools of interventional radiology to understand whether or not these tumors could be cryoablated. And I've had several cases where these are isolated liver lesions that come back years after, and we're able to have the patient undergo cryoablation, and we've avoided chemotherapy, we've avoided radiation therapy, we've avoided surgical intervention. It's case by case, I agree,
absolutely.
Right?
Yeah,
but I
sure.
mean, we oftentimes will refer our patients to our interventional colleagues at the Brigham and to address this question specifically. So the answer is yes, it's selective cases, but the answer is absolutely yes.
Yeah, I know, I think cryoablation, radiofrequency ablation, and the radiologist will pick what best therapy to use depending upon where the spot is and how safe to do it.
Yeah.
All right, quickly, before we wrap up, and I want to thank the audience today, Dr. Campos, what are you most excited about in the field of ovarian cancer right now?
I'm excited about the fact that things are changing and that we're no longer committed to simply chemotherapy of carboplatin and taxol. As Dr. Panos said, we're molecularly profiling these tumors. We're learning which genes actually turn on a tumor. And there's a whole category of drugs that we're starting to utilize, that we have utilized, and really tailoring the therapy to the individual. I think we've been doing this for many years, and I think what's the most exciting thing is that if you'd asked us 10 years where we were and to know where we are today, it's so much more exciting today because there are so many resources, and people can have fruitful lives with ovarian cancer.
Great. Panos?
I agree with Sue. I mean, I think that we have to strive to get to individualized, personalized therapy in ovarian cancer, similarly to what other cancer types is happening with other cancer types. I think what I feel is an exciting field is that we are starting to understand better now platinum and PARP inhibitor resistance and trying to find approaches to overcome this. This is something that I've been also involved in my laboratory efforts to try and understand this. So I think we live in exciting times in ovarian cancer research. A lot of novel drugs that are being developed, and I think that there is a bright future for our patients and to fight this difficult disease.
Yeah, and I'm certainly really excited about different combinations of therapies because mm-hmm. we know and understand the genetic and genomic complexity of ovarian cancer. Sue talked about anti-angiogenesis agents. Panels talked about PARP inhibitors, immunotherapy drugs. Well, we're going to start to combine these therapies together because sometimes one drug just doesn't work by itself. And it only makes sense that we combine these therapies because they really will tackle different innate problems in the cancer that really drive this tumor along. So I want to thank everyone in the audience. Dr. Sue Campos, thank you so much for being here. Dr. Panos Constantinopoulos, and a good day to you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.